Good morning and welcome to St. Michael and All Angels Online on this first Sunday after the Epiphany. On the first Sunday after the Epiphany each year, we celebrate the baptism of our Lord. We hear how Jesus was baptized in the River Jordan by John the Baptist, how the heavens opened and the Spirit descended upon him, and a voice, God's voice, proclaimed, "You are my son, the beloved." God says the same thing to each and every one of us. We are God's beloved children, called and chosen, washed in the waters of baptism, and united into the body of Christ. Let us gather with a sense of joy and celebration this morning. Let's pause for a moment and prepare ourselves for worship with the prelude music.
Thank you. Sunday of the Epiphany. It's good to have you here with us, and we are delighted to know that we're online, even if you can't be with us in person. I hope you're with us in spirit. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Heaven, who at the baptism of Jesus in the River Jordan proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit, grant that all who are baptized into his name may keep the covenant that they've made and boldly confess him as Lord and Savior, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis, Chapter 1, beginning at the first verse. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 29 together. Ascribe to the Lord, you gods. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty one waters. The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf, and Mount Hermon like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord splits the flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe and strips the forest bare. And in the temples of the Lord, all are crying glory. The Lord sits enthroned above the flood, and the Lord sits enthroned as King forevermore. The Lord shall give strength to his people. The Lord shall give his people the blessing of peace. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 19, beginning at the first verse. When Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Well, by now I assume that you have all packed away all your Christmas decorations, written all your thank you notes, and started on your New Year's resolutions. This 2021 feels a lot like the start of a brand new year. Most of us are quite happy that 2020 is now behind us. But whether you're ready for this new year or not, the church is ready. Advent and Christmas are history. And this is now the year that the church focuses on the Gospel of Mark. Year B, it is called. You know, year A, we focus on Matthew, year B on Mark, year C on Luke. And then John is kind of sprinkled in between all these years, but then we begin it all over again. The Gospel of Mark is believed to be the earliest gospel that was written. And it tells the story of Jesus' life, his death, his resurrection, as succinctly as possible and in great haste. Everything in the gospel happens immediately. That is Mark's favorite word. Mark does not spend a lot of time on long descriptive passages. The gospel opens with a simple statement explaining the subject of the book. Verses 1 and 2 tell you everything that you need to know. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophet Isaiah. So right away we understand that Jesus is the Christ, is the Son of God, and that this Son of God, this Messiah, had been forecast by the prophet centuries before. Jesus' arrival is really not a new thing. It is a continuation of a larger story of God and of God's people, and of how God makes God's self known in human history. In the next few verses, we are told about the arrival of John, who appears in the wilderness preaching about a baptism of repentance. He is preparing the way for the Lord. That's just as Isaiah had prophesied it. And before you know it, Jesus appears, and he is baptized by John. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens open up, and the Spirit descended upon him like a dove. And a voice came from the heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." And then the Spirit immediately drove Jesus out into the wilderness. Things move very fast in the Gospel of Mark. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't linger over some of the events that Mark mentions. On this day, the most important thing that happens in Jesus' life is his baptism and the voice that came from heaven. "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." Jesus' baptism was the moment at which God revealed himself by revealing Jesus' real identity. It was the point at which God publicly announced his entry into the human experience. "I am sending my beloved Son to you so that he can bring you to me." That's why we are invited to witness. That's what we are invited to witness on this first Sunday of the Epiphany. For Jesus, this was just a life-changing event. It marked the beginning of his public ministry and his entrance into our lives. This proclamation, this epiphany, came to Jesus not as a result of an extraordinary ministry, but before he had even begun his ministry. He had not even preached a single word or healed a single soul. No, God claimed Jesus to be his beloved Son just because he was beloved. And so it is with us. When we were baptized, we were united with Christ in his living, in his dying, in his rising again. We were symbolically submerged under the waters of baptism, just as Jesus was submerged under the swirling waters of the Jordan River. And in that moment of submersion, our old life was just washed away, and we came up out of the water, reborn into a new life in Christ. And then we were given an identifying label, a label that doesn't say who we are, but whose we are. We were sealed by the sign of the Holy Cross and marked as Christ's own forever. If we listened carefully, we might have heard that voice that said, "You are my beloved. You are my beloved." What an extraordinary thing to be told. What an extraordinary thing to hear. But how desperately we need to all hear that. God's voice saying to us that we are his beloved children, that he delights in us for no reason other than our existence. God does not love us because of what we have done, or might do. Rather, he loves us in spite of what we have done or might do. We need to believe that and to simply rest in that love and act out of that love. I know that sounds rather simplistic, but I'll bet the majority of the ills in this world stem from the fact that most people feel unloved and unlovable. And what a different place this world would be if those people only knew the truth. Our presiding Bishop Michael Curry speaks of the beloved community, and he calls all of us as Christians to foster the creation of such a kind of community, accepting and loving all people, regardless of the color of their skin, or their sexual orientation, or even, believe it or not, their political persuasions. In view of what has happened in our nation's capital this past week, I would say that that is the most important thing for all of us to focus on right now. There is so much hatred and anger and dis-ease in our country these days. We must find a way to bring people together to work for peaceful coexistence. We must seek a pathway toward reconciliation and justice and God's good grace. It is when we let God's love have its way with us that our lives become a channel for his grace and for his peace. I'm reminded of a young woman with whom I worked in a shelter for the homeless in New Haven quite a few years ago. I spent occasional nights there as a chaplain. She worked there every night. It was the custom in that shelter to search each of the residents as they entered, to make sure that they weren't bringing in weapons or anything else that was prohibited, such as alcohol or drugs or whatever. The majority of the staff were pretty brusque in the way that they went about this task. Clearly, they just wanted to get the job done, get it over with. But this woman had a way of treating each resident like they were really somebody. The task wasn't as important as the residents were. She would welcome each resident as they came in the door, look them in the eye, engage them in conversation, affirming them as human beings. And throughout the evening, I would see her moving through the crowd, gently laying a hand on a drooping shoulder, listening intently to a tale of woe, offering to help a tired old man make up his bed. I noticed that each person she connected with seemed to stand a little bit taller and look a little bit more hopeful. Young or old, black or white, sane or not sane, didn't matter to her. They were all God's children, and she reached out unceasingly to share God's love with each one of them. I haven't wondered how she got her energy and her infinite patience. I think now she just let God's love have its way with her, and he gave her the strength night after night. We are also called to share that love that's been freely given to us with those who are yearning for it. And we are called to bring justice and peace and to be agents of peaceful change. However, our activities, I think, are doomed to failure if we try to act independently of God. It is his spirit that heals. It is his spirit that can restore peace to a troubled world, and his love that empowers. All that becomes clearer and clearer as we follow Jesus' footsteps, as we follow him in the Gospel of Mark during this Epiphany season. As we follow him, we will hear bits and pieces of the good news, where Jesus reveals to us the meaning of life as God would have it be. He tells us that God has a purpose for each one of us. He shows us how to live together in a way that will bring universal peace and joy. And he promises life in all of its abundance to those who give their lives to him. The more we walk with Jesus, the more we realize that the love we have been given to us is really meaningless unless we give it away. It's not enough to hold on to that love for our own sense of security. We must carry it to others. We must strive to make it a reality for everyone. The more we journey with Christ, the more we realize that just as he gave infinite love to all whom he encountered along the way, we are called to do the same. At our baptism, We're told to seek and to serve Christ in all persons, loving our neighbor as ourselves, and to strive for justice and peace among all people, respecting the dignity of every human being. When we were baptized, we were symbolically dyed to our old way of life in order to be reborn in Christ. When we take that seriously, it means that we may have to give up some things to which we have become accustomed. Our complacency, our safe way of life, our compromises, our rationalizations, our prejudices. Being God's beloved doesn't put us in some kind of a special, privileged sort of category, a category that will exempt us from the pain and the brokenness of life. No, to the contrary, being beloved puts us in a line with the whole human race. And being members of the same family, we are responsible for one another's well-being and to share in one another's suffering. So if one part of the human race is broken, we all share in that brokenness. Now, that doesn't sound like very good news. And it might be very bad news if it were not for the fact that as we follow Jesus, he continues to walk with us and promises never to leave us, but instead to love us, to a wholeness that we could just barely imagine, to give meaning to our lives and peace to our souls. Through our baptism, we are assured that no matter what, we are beloved and chosen forever. And that is an amazing thing to know. Amen.
This feast of the baptism of our Lord, we will reaffirm our faith with the words and the promises of the baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship and the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
We offer prayers for all God's people on earth. May we be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican province of Alexandria, and in our own diocese, St. Peter's Cathedral, St. Petersburg. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We offer prayers for all lay people, bishops, priests, and deacons. May they reverently serve you, delight in sound teaching, and truly live out the gospel. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We offer prayers for all in positions of authority and public trust. Guide them in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We offer prayers for peace and justice in our own nation and in every corner of the world, for an end to violence and divisions between us. May we be instruments of healing and peace. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those affected by COVID-19, whose lives have been disrupted, who are quarantined, who have been infected, and for those who have died. Comfort those who are fearful, cheer those who are depressed, and protect those who have remained healthy. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the aged and infirm, and for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, especially for Gail Pilibosian, Betty Cater, and Johnny Magaha, for Ralph Korn, Debbie Kelmerite, Peter B., Walt Kusser, and Kristen Belts, for Merrill Rushworth, Judy Workman, Martha and David Valls, for Claudia Johnson, John Bordieri, Ed Perellis, Wayne and Martha Poneder, for Paula Traxler, Jan Pearson Graham, Claudia and Jack Upper, for Gretchen Van Waltrop, Polly Penny, George Craig, and Mary Lou Flynn. We pray also, silently or aloud, for friends and family members whom we carry in our hearts. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, O God, for all of our many blessings. We pray for those celebrating birthdays, Sue Van Oss, Roger Foote, Valerie Cleaver, Margaret Duncan, Tina Hunter, Marnikia Bradley, Chris Kirshner, Mary Nelson, Alan Gast, Jean Stanton, and Nancy Paul. And for those celebrating anniversaries, Jacqueline and Thomas Wash. Pour out your blessings upon them. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Bless all who have died, especially for Helen Ann Van Buskirk, mother of Janice Van Buskirk, who died this week. May they enjoy eternal peace and gladness in your presence, where sorrow and sighing are no more, in the company of the communion of saints. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Saying together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways for the glory of your name.
Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ,
strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
And now may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And also with you.
Peace.
And peace be with all of you, too.
Peace be with you.
Let us now with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and our labor to the Lord.
Saw you never in the twilight, when the sun had left the skies, up in heaven the clear stars shining, through the gloom like silver eyes. So of old the wise men watching saw a little stranger star, and they knew the king was given, and they followed it from far. Heard you never of the story, how they crossed the desert wild, journeyed on by plain and mountain, till they found the Holy Child. How they opened all their treasure, kneeling to that infant king, gave the gold and fragrant incense, gave the myrrh in offering.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. to you, O God, for the goodness and the love which you have made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that it may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
In union, O Lord, with your faithful people at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer you praise and thanksgiving. We remember your death, Lord Christ. We proclaim your resurrection. We await your coming in glory. Since we cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. Cleanse and strengthen us with your grace, Lord Jesus, and let us never be separated from you. May we live in you, and you in us, in this life and in the life to come. Amen.
Make me a channel of your
pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Just a few announcements this morning. Betty Cater says she'll be down on the 15th, and she's very excited about that. Janice Van Buskirk and her siblings, Lauren and Mark, need your prayers following the loss of their mother. And please pray, too, for all who are becoming anxious about the process of getting a vaccine. Pray for patience and calm in the midst of all of this. Our Zoom coffee social hour at 11:30 this morning. You can find the link in the Friday brief. Remember the neighborhood stewardship gatherings on Zoom. They're Tuesdays and Thursdays for the next 2 weeks at 5 p.m. There's a reservation link in the Friday brief. You can also call Susan Gonzalez to reserve a place for one of the neighborhood stewardship gatherings. So it's Tuesdays and Thursdays, 5 p.m. for the next 2 weeks. The Red Door is out, and there are lots of things in there. One of the highlights is that Ann Kimball and James Davis will be offering a wonderful series called Sacred Ground. It's a program of our National Episcopal Church. You can find out details in the Red Door and sign up for that. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you. now in the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In another time of national crisis, another time of danger for our nation, in 1865, on March the 4th, Abraham Lincoln concluded his second inaugural address with these words: "With malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right, let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations." Lincoln knew in that moment, in the moment of a national crisis, a moment of great danger, that such a moment was a moment of decision, when a nation, when a people must decide, who shall we be? What kind of nation, what kind of people shall we be? 100 years later, Martin Luther King faced the same reality. Who shall we be? The civil rights movement was waning. The great victories that had been won, and yet now questions of poverty and economic despair and disparities raised an awesome specter on the nation. We were at war. We were at war in another country, but there was war on our streets. The nation was deeply divided. Cities burned. There were riots. Riots at national conventions of political parties. The future of the nation was in question. And it was at that time that Dr. King realized that in moments of danger, a decision must be made. And he titled his last book, "Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community?" I believe, as he believed, as Abraham Lincoln believed, as I believe you believe, that we must choose community. Chaos is not an option. Community is our only hope. The truth is, Dr. King spoke often of all that he did and labored for was for the purpose of realizing as much of the beloved community of God as is possible on this earth. He spoke of beloved community. The Bible, the New Testament, Jesus spoke of the kingdom or the reign of God. Jesus taught us to pray and to work and to labor for that beloved community, that reign of God's love in our time and in our world. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth just as it is in heaven. Those are our marching orders from Jesus himself. I am a follower of Jesus of Nazareth because I believe that his way of love and his way of life is the way of life for us all. I believe that unselfish, sacrificial love, love that seeks the good and the welfare and the well-being of others as well as the self, that this is the way that can lead us and guide us to do what is just, to do what is right, to do what is merciful. It is the way that can lead us beyond the chaos to community. Now I know full well that this may to some sound naive, to others idealistic. And I understand that. And yet, I want to submit that the way of love that leads to beloved community is the only way of hope for humanity. Consider the alternative. The alternative is chaos, not community. The alternative is the abyss of anarchy, of chaos, of hatred, of bigotry, of violence. And that alternative is unthinkable. We have seen nightmarish visions of that alternative. We saw it in Charlottesville just a few years ago when neo-Nazis marched through the streets of an American city, chanting, "Jews will not replace us." That alternative is unthinkable. We saw it in Minneapolis, St. Paul, where a public safety officer knelt with his knee on the neck of another human being, a child of God, just like he was, and snuffed out the breath of life that God gave him. The alternative is unthinkable. And we have seen it this past Wednesday when a monument to democracy, the capital of the United States of America, was desecrated and violated with violence by vandals. Lives were lost. A nation was wounded. Democracy itself was threatened. My brothers and sisters, this way of love that Jesus taught us when he said, "Love the Lord your God and your neighbor as yourself," this way of love that Moses taught even before Jesus, this way of unselfish, sacrificial love, it is the way to redeem a nation, to save a world. It is the way of hope for us all. But do not make the mistake of thinking that I speak of a sentimental and emotional love. Jesus spoke of love most consistently the closer he got to the cross. This way of love is the way of sacrifice, the way of unselfishness, the way of selflessness that seeks the good of the other as well as the self. And that is the way of the cross, which is the way of life. And if you don't believe me, ask another apostle of love. Not Dr. King, not Abraham Lincoln. Ask Archbishop Tutu. Ask one who has given his life for the cause of God's love in the way of Jesus. Ask him. Ask Nelson Mandela in your mind. Ask them what love looks like. They knew that the way of love was the only way that could guide South Africa from what could have become a bloody nightmare in civil war to the way that could build a nation. And it was not sentimental. Remember truth and reconciliation. They had to face painful truths. They had to do what was just. and what was merciful. They had to do what the prophet Micah said. But the motivation and the guide was love. Archbishop Tutu said this: love, forgiving, and being reconciled to our enemies or our loved ones is not about pretending that things are other than they are. It is not about patting one another on the back or turning a blind eye to the wrong. True reconciliation exposes the awfulness of the abuse, the hurt, the truth. It could even sometimes make things worse for a while. It is a risky undertaking, but in the end, it is worthwhile, because in the end, only an honest confrontation with reality can bring forth real healing. Superficial reconciliation only brings superficial healing. This is the way of love that can heal our hurts, that can heal our land, and that can help us to become one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So I would ask you to do two things. I'm asking you to make a commitment, a renewed commitment, to live the way of love as Jesus has taught us, and to do it by making a commitment to go out and bless somebody. Bless somebody you disagree with. Bless somebody you agree with. But to go out and bless somebody by helping somebody along the way. Go out and bless somebody by listening to their story and their life. To go out and be an instrument of God's peace, an agent of God's love. And then I would ask you to pray. Pray for this nation, but pray with some specificity. Pray that we may have the wisdom and the courage to love. God of grace and God of glory, on thy people pour thy power. Crown thine ancient church's story. Bring her bud to glorious flower. Grant us wisdom. Grant us courage for the facing of this hour. With malice toward none, with charity toward all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right. Let us strive to finish the work that we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. God love you. God bless you. And may God hold us all in those almighty hands of love.